Well, believe it or not, you join us right here on the road for the first of two very special programs. And we're heading right now out of the city of Belfast along the five lanes of the northbound carriageway of the M2, travelling towards a red brick edifice which dominates the entire skyline of the north shore of Belfast Lough on the suburbs of the city. We're paying a very special visit this week and next to the home of the UK's largest congregation, Whitewell Metropolitan Tabernacle. Under the leadership of Pastor James McConnell, this assembly of people has grown to some 3,000 members and has some 7,000 people, yes, 7,000 people, pass through the gates of this marvelous place each week. The church has a wide-ranging music ministry in the form of various singing groups, and it even has a mixed choir of some 360 members alone. The church is also a regular concert venue for many of the visiting gospel music stars from all over the world, especially the United States. And they include some that we have even featured on our programs from time to time, like the Palmetto State Quartet, Gold City, and Larry Ford, to name a few. Not forgetting, of course, visiting friends of the famous Gaithers, who feature on some of their wonderful music videos. And we trust you'll stay with us here on the Hour of Deliverance as we talk at length on this program and the next to James McConnell and learn of his life and ministry and the phenomenon, which is the Metropolitan Tabernacle. Listening to the sound of 4,000 people in worship recorded at the venue for this very special program. It's the great Metropolitan Tabernacle at Whitewell on the outskirts of the city of Belfast. This really beautiful complex housing a 4,000 plus seat auditorium. It has conference facilities and an all-day restaurant. It was built out of the dedication and the sacrifice of the congregation of Whitewell Metropolitan Tabernacle, under the leadership of James McConnell, its founder and senior pastor. And it's James McConnell that we're here to talk to today, and we trust that you really enjoy his remarkable story on this program and the next one as well. But first, some more music, this time from the 360 strong Metropolitan Mixed Choir.
I had gone till I just couldn't go anymore. My faith had walked right out the door. I thought there was just no way I could ever be free. But someone looked at me with love and concern and started to let their prayer wheels turn. Glory, hallelujah, somebody touched God for me.
Somebody touched God. When I was down, he picked me up, he turned me around, went to the throne of God to intercede.
Well, when I was sinking in despair, my brothers and my sisters held me up in prayer. When I was weak, somebody touched God for me. God told Moses, if you want to win, keep your hands in the air to the very end. But he got so tired that they were facing defeat. With one on the left, another on the right, they held up his hands till the end of the fight. Intercessory prayer helped win the victory.
It's a great privilege for us here in the Hour of Deliverance once again to be in the company of our very dear friend, Pastor James McConnell. Pastor James McConnell is the senior pastor in the Whitewell Metropolitan Church. He has written two books. His first book was in 1987, called The Light on a Hill. Fairly recently, his second book, called The Seer's House, a great publication and one that I can highly recommend to you. Now, James was born in the late 30s in East Belfast, in the shadow of the mighty Belfast shipyard, Harland and Wolff, which is still there until this very day. Do you ever call in that area to the old homestead?
Many times. Sometimes at night I would drive, you know, just for a drive from the house, take a drive around the old Spring Street area and the Woodstock Road area, cut down the Newton Arch Road down to the old shipyard and enjoy, you know, and reminisce all the years.
Well, even as a young man living in that particular area, and your father, of course, he worked in the Harland and Wolff shipyard, as did many of the men in that particular area. In fact, at that time, I think there was in the region of about 20,000 people.
That's right.
And they came from different parts. But even as a young man, you went to church every Sunday with your mother, Jean. And you also went to Sunday school in the Iron Hall Mission. I've had the privilege of being in that church on a few occasions. And even then, as a young boy, you had that desire to be a Christian. What gave you that desire?
I think the influence of my grandparents, particularly my grandfather, who was an elder in the Iron Hall. He was an old country man from Tubbermore, and he couldn't read or write. And that always struck me, that my grandfather couldn't read or write. But yet, God taught him how to read. And he used to read this large Bible in the old homestead in 10 Perry Street. And when he put it down, I would lift it up and read it. And I used to love reading 1 and 2 Samuel. And those have become my favourite books of the Bible. And I'm writing a commentary on 1 and 2 Samuel at the minute. But that was the influence of my grandfather. Then on the Sunday school in the Iron Hall, my Sunday school teacher, Sammy Jemison, a wonderful young man. And he led me to the Saviour. One day I was listening to him and the Spirit of God spoke to me. And I just said, this is it. I was 7.5 years of age. And I gave my life to Christ. And Sammy knelt down with me in the old form on the Sunday school and led me to the Saviour. And the wonderful part about it is my Sunday school teacher, who's well up in years now, Sammy Jemison.
Still alive.
He is still alive and he attends my church and is a member of the church.
Right.
He and his family, and they really, they've been members now about 15 years.
Oh, that's beautiful.
And they came from the Iron Hall and came to me. And so they've been a real blessing here.
Must be a very proud man today.
I'm delighted, you know, just to see him sitting there, you know.
Yeah, well, even then, as a young boy of 7.5 years of age, your teacher recognized that there was something different about you and he nurtured you in the things of God for many years. Even then, he was only 18 years of age himself.
He was. He was a young man engaged in youth work, and he was in youth work for many years in the Iron Hall. He was there from a baby. He just spent a lifetime there.
Things, however, didn't always go well for you in your young life, because you were just about 8 years of age when your mother, Jean, died. That must have left a very big gap in your life and in your home. And your father, at that particular time, he suffered from tuberculosis and cancer, and he was in hospital quite a lot as well. So the only thing for you to do at that particular point, Pastor James, was to move in with your grandparents.
I did.
And they were a great influence and an encouragement to you, as they were both believers themselves. Is that right?
That's right.
Yeah.
And I used to hear my grandfather praying at 7:30 every morning. He went down to the little parlour room, knelt down. He used to open up one of those old redemption song hymns and sing at the top of his voice. Another thing about it, he was deaf.
Yeah.
And you know what deaf people are, they speak loud.
Yeah.
And they think he would come to me at the end of his prayer time and he said, son, had a lovely wee quiet time with the Lord. And the whole of Perry Street heard him. You know, and that was the type of man that he was. Loved the Lord. He used to visit the hospitals and bring sweets and stuff around there to them and minister to the people and led many a soul to Christ. Yeah. So that lovely influence was there.
And that's remained with you, because whenever I come to this church, even with the marvelous amplification that there is, we can always still hear your voice. So I presume you've taken that after your grandfather, even to this day. But I also read in your book that even whenever you come home from school, James, that you love nothing better than to lift your grandfather's Bible and to study. That seems a bit peculiar for a young man. doesn't it? Coming home from school and reading the Bible. Did you have any other hobbies or interests?
Yes, football. Reading the scriptures and playing football. That was a strange combination. But I think I had a sense of insecurity with my mother gone and my father being so ill. And then my father dying. Then my sister taking tuberculosis. I had that feeling of insecurity. And my grandparents, who were very old, you know, and I realized that they couldn't always look after me. I remember having an experience one morning of standing at the foot of the stairs when some of the members of the family were there and they were debating if anything happened to my father or my sister, who would look after me. And listening to them talk gave me that terrible sense of insecurity.
Yes.
And I remember creeping back into the room and getting down on my knees and saying, Father, keep me, look after me. And you know, he gave me a confidence. And I think that's what drove me to the scriptures. When I read the scriptures, that gave me the comfort and the strength that I needed at that particular time. And then combining it with football, it was the only thing I felt I could do well in those days, play football. And I was aiming for a career, Wilbur. Was aiming for a career.
Right.
And I remember when I was even pastoring the church, I reached the age of 28, and there was a group of young men. There was about 20 of them. And in those days, there was no television as we know it today.
Yeah.
And only the rich had the television.
Yeah.
But then UTV came out and so forth. But I remember holding those boys and forming a football team.
Yeah.
And our meetings then was Tuesdays and Thursdays. And then Monday, Wednesday and Friday, I was playing football with them, even on Saturdays. And unconsciously, I had played myself back to fitness.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Jackie Milburn had come over from Newcastle to play for Linfield.
Correct, he had.
And he played for the Blues for 2.5 years, and he was leaving them. And one night when I was at the prayer meeting, and this is when we were renting the Orange Hall, he came down and rapped my door at 128 King's Road, and he says, is there a man called James McConnell here? And my wife says, he's at the prayer meeting. He says, well, I'm down to sign him for Linfield. Huh? He was leaving. And he was wanting a centre forward to take my place. And he said, tell him he is assured of a place in the team if he would sign. But my wife said, there's no way that he will sign. He's pastoring a church and he's engaged in spiritual things.
Yes.
So that was quite a telling moment in my life.
It was indeed. The famous Jackie Milburn.
The famous War Jackie. He came down to sign me.
Yeah, yeah. I remember him well. Your grandparents, James, taught you much about prayer. And it was not unusual for you to go along with your grandfather to the Iron Hall Church to go to the prayer meetings. But I read also that you asked the elders some questions. Was that not a bit unusual? Did they accept that all right, you as a young man, asking them questions?
Yes, they were very kind. They were very gentle. They were lovely old boys, you know.
You think they've seen your potential?
I don't know what they've seen, but they were very kind. But the only thing that I was angry at them was, I used to go to the breaking of bread. They had their breaking of bread on a Sunday morning at 10:30.
Yeah.
And then their service at 11:30. And Pastor Tyle Evans was the pastor then. And they used to take a loaf of bread and cut it in half and just stick their fingers in it, you know, and partake of the Lord's Supper. And every Sunday morning, my grandfather lifted that bread and wine over my head and wouldn't give it to me. He said I was too young to break bread. And I was angry at him for doing that because I felt, he deprived me of something that was special, you know. But I forgive him for that anyway. Yeah.
Well, it was while you were living, of course, with your grandparents then that another great gap came in your life, because you were only about 13 at that particular time and your father passed away as well.
Yeah.
However, the consolation for you was that both your parents had accepted Christ as their Savior before they died. You started attending a small Pentecostal fellowship called the Bible Pattern Church. Pattern Church. I remember that as a young boy. Are they still on the go, those people?
As far as I know, there's one or two churches still there, but the little church on My Lady's Road, it has changed hands. But I remember then it was after the break that George Jeffries had made with Elam many years ago and he founded the Bible Pattern. So I started to attend that little church. There was about 30 at it. And they were mostly elderly people.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was the only young person there, and they spoiled me rotten. There's no doubt about it. They loved me and looked after me. I can see them yet. They seem to wear the same suits for 30 years, the same coats, you know. They seem to wear, you know, and they never change them, but the same yesterday, today, and forever, you know. But it was there that I got a good grounding in the Pentecostal witness, and I enjoyed it very much indeed.
Well, you weren't very long at that church until these people began to really sit up and take notice that here was a young man that had some potentials, because they even entrusted you with the keys of the church.
That's right.
That was a big plus mark, because those were very sacred places to those type of people.
That's right.
So they give you the keys of the church, and you went in, opened the church, put the lights on and put the heat on. I got a wave of enjoyment when I read that, because I remember as a young fellow, I used to do that myself at times. And I wasn't very good at praying, so I used to sneak a little prayer on my own. So something like this happened to yourself, because there was something very exciting happened. You were sitting and you were singing at the radiator, and all of a sudden you had this most wonderful experience.
That's right. It was actually in the morning. It was at 7:30. Some mornings I used to go there about 7 o'clock, 6:30, and put the heat on. And the place was roasting by the time they came in. But this particular morning, I had knelt down at the heater. It was a winter's morning. I don't know how the lady came. I don't know.
Because you closed the door.
That's right. She was a lovely lady. She was actually an academic. She was a very highly intelligent woman who came to the little church. And we were just ordinary people then. And I always remember, because she always looked good. She dressed good.
Yeah.
You know. But here, this particular morning, the door's locked. I'm singing, "Take My Life and Let It Be, Consecrated, Lord, to Thee." And here she burst in and said, "Thus saith the Lord, I am going to lift you up and use you. I am going to take you to many countries in the world. I'm going to put my evangel inside you. And when you speak, men and women will come to me." Well, can you imagine the feeling that that would give a young man of 13, 14 years of age?
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's just scared the life out of me.
You were dumbfounded, yeah.
Absolutely. And she was really a prophetess.
Yeah.
You know, and a wee bit eccentric while being an academic, and their eyes blazing. And can you see this woman coming in with flowing hair doing this?
Just at 7:30 in the morning.
Definitely scared the life out of me. And still to this day, I don't know how she got to the church. She must have got a taxi. She must have got something. I was that shocked I didn't ask her how she got. So it was so early on a Sunday morning.
Then she's just gone as quickly almost.
And away she went again and left me on my knees. Away she went.
Hmm.
And I never communicated with her since. And that was a long, long time ago.
Well, shortly after that experience, that same little Pentecostal fellowship came right into your street, and little did you know at that particular time that that was the beginning of your preaching ministry, because Head Constable Leeburn.
That's right.
A gentleman that I too, Pastor James, had the privilege of meeting. Did he have a little church in Abba Street too?
Yes, he went to Abba Street for a while.
Yes.
After the little pattern church closed down,
yes,
they went there.
That's where I met him. But Head Constable Leeburn, he was a leader in the church, and he asked you that particular day at the open air meeting to testify. Now, it must have taken great courage to have done that, especially with all your neighbours around, some of your mates.
I dreaded it because they went around the whole district after church, and it was the summer nights. And here he says, "We're doing Spring Street." And he says, "And we're standing outside Jimmy McConnell's door." Well, I near fainted. And all my mates were there. And he said, "And now you know this young man," he says. "I want him to come and tell you how the Lord saved him." And I had to go into the center of the ring.
No option.
And give him a testimony and all the neighbors out. Well, if I never lived for God, I started to live for God then, because everybody knew in Spring Street that I was saved, and they were watching me like a hawk afterwards. So I started to live for the Lord.
Yeah. Well, some preaching engagements followed. And then one night you went to the famous Wellington Hall, right in the centre of our beautiful city of Belfast, to hear the great George Jeffreys. And there was another little experience then, but it wasn't during the service. It was right at the very end of the service.
Well, George Jeffreys, every boy has his idol. You know, they have idols in football.
In games, yeah,
and
sports.
I had my idols in football, but George Jeffreys was my idol as a preacher.
Hmm.
He was a wonderful leader. He had polish with the power. And that's what I loved. He had polish with the power. We see so many today who have the power, but they haven't the polish. He had both. He combined it. There was that beautiful balance. And I remember him preaching that night at Wellington Hall, and there was no coat hangers for your coat. And I remembered as well, and I had thrown my wee Dexter over a chair. And with the crowd thronging, you know, to get out, I was more or less the last to get out because I hung about and I was looking for my coat. And I remember finding it. And I remember these two big arms going round me and saying, "Hold on, boy, put your hand in this sleeve." And I put my hand in it. And he says, "Put your other hand in this one." And he put the coat round me, and it was the principal himself. And when he put the coat on me, he put his arms right round my neck and he hugged me. And he said, "God bless you." And that was a wonderful experience for me.
Not to be forgotten.
And it was like, do you know what it was like? Elijah,
yes,
in that field, casting his mantle over young Elisha.
Yeah.
And then young Elisha turning around and following him.
Yeah.
Now, that had an effect on me, which I will not. I still remember him, the black coat, the striped trousers, the white shirt, the black tie with the spots in it,
yes,
the cuffs down, beautiful, and the
immaculate
Old Spice aftershave, which I have worn every day since.
He certainly was your idol, wasn't he? At 15 years of age, you were invited quite a lot to preach. Now, this is a personal question. Do you think that you were invited because it was a type of novelty to see someone so young? Because most preachers in those days, I'm sure you'll agree, James, were of the older type.
They were. In fact, the preachers of those days were great preachers. And the sad thing is we don't have great preachers today. And that breaks my heart to see the decline in Christian ministry. But in those days, Northern Ireland was full of tremendous preachers. Now, I think it was the novelty.
You think so?
I think so. It wasn't brilliant. I think it was the novelty of a young boy anointed by the Spirit of God. It was the anointing that carried me through.
Yes.
It wasn't always the things that I said.
No.
But as I was continually asked to minister, naturally I improved.
Oh, yeah.
Naturally I had to study. And I became the boy preacher, and I was preaching everywhere. Preaching even in England, Scotland, Wales, everywhere. But the novelty soon wore off later on.
I read in the book that you were in your late teens when God brought two very important men into your life, Pastor Gordon McGee and Pastor James Forsyth.
That's right.
Now, I heard of Pastor Gordon McGee when I was a young boy. I never met him, but James Forsyth I have met. In fact, we have met him.
Yes.
Wonderful. A little man, but a giant for God.
He was.
Isn't that right?
They had
a great effect on your life.
Great effect. And James Forsyth, I can honestly say he taught me how to worship, taught me how to pray. Gordon McGee taught me how to deliver God's word. Gordon McGee was one of the greatest preachers that I've ever heard in my life. Dynamic, a real Bible student, and a theologian. Mm-hmm. Okay, a controversialist. So those that would, you know, put a question mark over me because of my association with them, they don't realize that I had no home, and those men took me into
That's
their home.
Correct.
Give me a home, give me a bed, looked after me, fed me, clothed me. And people wanted me to denounce those men.
No.
How could I?
You can't.
I would be biting the hand that fed you. Mm-hmm. Those men, they were angels of God sent to me to nurture me and to build me up for what I have today.
After the schooling, these two men give you the opportunity to go to the northeast of England, to Newcastle area. They came your way and it proved a very successful experience for you. It also was the beginning of a full-time evangelistic ministry for you whenever you moved over to the Gateshead, Newcastle area. That was you finished with the shipyard and so forth.
That was me finished with Harland and Wolfe.
Yeah.
It was a sad day leaving because the men there were very good to me, knowing that I had no parents.
Yes.
Those men looked after me and loved me. But I think they saw my life and they saw my testimony. And I remember them saying farewell to me. Some of them came and heard me after a period of years when I had my own church. But I remember going to Gateshead on Coatsworth Road, and it was a small building, but God moved so much inside 6 months. We had to book the Sutherland Hall, which held 750 persons.
What age were you at that time?
I was 18, and I stayed there for a year. then I came back to Northern Ireland and became an assistant to Pastor Forsyth on the Shankill Road,
yes,
to his church in Craven Street. And then after that, God began to open the door of this great house that, yes, we're in today, which, yes, took over a period of 41 years.
It was whenever you came back to Belfast, and it was during a mission back here in the city, that your own sister Lila came to give her heart to the Lord.
That's right.
That must have been a great thrill.
It was. It was a wonderful time to see her coming to the Lord and to see her receiving the Holy Spirit. It was wonderful. Also at that mission, Robert Gass, who is the main speaker of the UCB, he came to the Lord during that mission.
During that mission.
That's right. Yeah. And his brother Neil Gass came to the Lord during that mission. Sidney Murray came to the Lord during that mission.
Some great things happened.
It was quite
time.
A mission.
Yes.
And there was 33 converts in 10 days, and the 33, every one of them went on with God.
Yes, I read that.
So that was what you would call the seed falling on good
beautiful.
Ground.
As you developed in the preaching ministry, of course, many other offers came in for you to preach from around Europe. There was even offers came from Germany and Holland and Sweden, and even some from the USA.
That's right.
So I read in your book that there was some money floating about as well then. They were offering different things, and of course it was tickling your ears at that time and very, very hard to refuse. That was your idea of going, but these two brethren, Pastor Gordon McGee and
they spoiled
Pastor
all that.
James Forsyth, they put their foot on it.
They did.
And they had other plans for you.
Well, they had.
And those plans were the complete opposite
that's
to
right.
what you had.
Well, Wilbur, at that time, the world was my oyster, preaching everywhere, having the time of my life. And I remember them coming to the house one day, and they said, look, there's 10 people down on the Whitewell Road area. They want to start a church. Now, Jim, do you fancy taking it? And I said, 10 people? I says, fellas, no way. Sure, I'm going to Scandinavia. I'm going here. I'm going there. Mm-hmm. I'm going to the States. And I remember Gordon McGee saying, that's okay, Jim, we'll go to someone else. Hmm. They mentioned the man's name to me. And I says, well, these people are wanting somebody urgently. I says, 10 people? He says, yes, they're wanting someone. And I said, no, it's not for me. And I remember when they left, half an hour later, a terrible depression came over me. Yeah. It was like a sinner under conviction. I had never felt it in my life. Now, when I came to the Lord as a young boy of 7 and a half, it was a gentle leading from the Savior. That's Sammy Jamison. But this was Holy Ghost conviction. And I got down on my knees and I said, Lord, what is it? And the Holy Ghost said, I want you to look after those 10 people. And I want you to tell them. So I waited and they didn't get back till late. And I remember saying, Brother McGee, Brother Forsyth, I'm taking that church. He said, you can't. We've already spoken to the man. He's going to take it. I says, tell him he hasn't to take it. Mm-hmm.
Worthy, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy, worthy is the Lamb.
About Sweden, you're going to Stockholm. Says, what about Holland? I said, it's all out of the wind. It's funny. The Holy Ghost has asked me to do this, and I'm doing it. And they went and told the man, and I started to take over this church with 10 people. Now, I'll never forget that. That was a real experience of Holy Ghost conviction. That coming upon me like a sinner, realizing what I'm doing is wrong here. Me going to the States is wrong. Me going to Holland is wrong. Me going to Germany is wrong. Really Holy Ghost conviction. He said, I want you to look after 10 people. And from that day, the boy preacher was never heard of. From that day, I was buried for 12 years. Nobody ever saw me for the next 12 years.
That was really the cornerstone of the Whitewell Church whenever you took over that little hall, because you had lots of hard times trudging the area,
That's
knocking
right.
on the doors and going home to the little flat you had because you'd moved into the north part of the city from the east. So it was hard days for you then.
Very difficult days.
Were you totally on your own in that?
I was totally on my own. And then in 1959, I got married. Yes. I was 2 years in the church and then I got married. Uh-huh. Margaret came down and we were living on the Doak Road in Kings Park.
Yeah.
But those were very difficult years when the church was small. But about maybe on a good Sunday morning with 35 people breaking bread. And on a Sunday night, if we had 60, we were doing very well indeed. Mm-hmm. And that went on for 12 solid years.
Of course, that was a big improvement, of course, James, from the 10.
Well, it was. Yes, it was. We grew. But the trouble in those days, people were going in through the front door and going out through the back door.
Mm-hmm.
So you weren't holding everybody.
No.
But it was difficult days. And then in the middle of that, we purchased this piece of ground. God got us the money. Yeah. We purchased this piece of ground and we started to put up a building.
Now, I know that whenever you started off, especially in Devon Parade, you weren't really a preacher at all. You were the song leader. Isn't that right?
That's right.
And you're still very fond of music. I still enjoy whenever you lead us in worship sometimes. Really beautiful. Because I'm very much into that myself. And have you a favourite song that your famous choir sings? Is there one of the songs that strikes you most?
I think my favourite song, it's sung by my choir leader, who is also the musical director,
Pastor Norman.
The Anchor Holds.
The Anchor Holds, yes.
I love
beautiful.
That song and the choir.
And that's on the CD, of course,
that's
I'm sure.
When
yeah.
they sing that, yeah.
I have journeyed through the long dark night out on the open sea. By faith my sight unknown, and yet his eyes watching me. The
example that your grandfather showed to you in those early days to pray much and take everything to God, big or small, I'm of the firm opinion, even to this very day, that that's why this church, not so much, well, quite a lot to do with you, but that's why this church is so successful, because of the prayer warriors and
that's
the
right.
prayer meetings that are held.
Yes.
In this church, there's about six or seven prayer meetings per week.
There's eight prayer meetings a week in this
church. Eight prayer meetings.
And those prayer meetings are very necessary. There's a prayer meeting every morning at 9 o'clock, plus the large prayer meeting on a Monday night. There's over 800 go to that prayer meeting on a Monday night. And can you imagine 800 people praying on a Monday night? It's fantastic. Then we have another prayer meeting on a Friday night while the choir practice is going on. That's a smaller prayer meeting. We get about 150 at that. So there's 800 on a Monday night, there's 150 on a Friday night, and then there's that faithful group of about 50 people every morning seeking God's face. And then some of the members have little prayer meetings in their homes as well, and they pray for the work. Mm-hmm. And I believe that that has been the secret of this house, the prayer, because prayer mellows a man.
Yes.
And it's in prayer that God reveals the will, mm-hmm. his will to you. and God reveals his plan and his purpose. Mm-hmm. And those things have been very necessary.
The backbone of this church.
The backbone, in fact, they're more important to us than money and wealth. That's mm-hmm. our wealth, the prayer meetings of Whitewell.
Mm-hmm. And then, of course, there's the midweek Wednesday night
Bible study.
Yeah, it's pretty famous here in the city.
I remember, strange that you should say this, Wilbur, there's 1,100 attending the Bible study now. We're touching 1,100 to 1,200 now every Wednesday night.
Yes.
Now, I remember my wife and I had moved to Serpentine Road. I was sitting on a little poofy one Saturday night looking at the Belfast Telegraph, and I noticed that Willie Mullen was starting his Bible classes, for the year.
Yeah.
And he was on the life of Daniel, and I remember saying, "Here's me, Lord, going down to these 30 people tomorrow morning. Willie Mullen's got 600 people at his Bible class. Lord, would you ever give me a Bible class like that?" And God has heard me. He's given me a Bible class of 1,100 to 1,200 people.
Yes.
And I'm so grateful for what he has done.
Earlier on, you mentioned your wife, Margaret, and I don't know whether you know this or not, but I knew Margaret before you.
Yes, she told me that.
I did. Yeah. Yes. I knew Margaret whenever I was a shoe representative. Your wife, Margaret, was the buyer in one of the stores on the Newtonards Road.
That's right.
And little did I think that that quiet, unassuming girl would marry James McConnell, who was so robust and fiery.
That's right.
However, Margaret must have found it a bit difficult at that particular time, James, whenever you got married, because you were so much caught up and committed to your work. And it must have been a bit of a setback for her, because here she was, a young wife, and she was found at home. But however, Margaret really got behind you. She was 100% behind you. And even to this day, she's really the strong woman behind the man.
Well, it was difficult the first 12 years because we had nothing.
Yes.
We labored there and we had absolutely nothing. But she went through it. But God has rewarded her for it. And God has blessed us and prospered us in many, many ways. But she was the backbone there with the family. And my oldest daughter, Linda, is now the administrator of this church.
That's correct.
And does a fantastic job. And who's also married to Norman Hobson, who is the musical director and is a pastor in this church as well. So God has been good to us as a family.
Because of the very strong stance that you take for truth and naturally, your fiery preaching, I'm sure some of the churches in the large Whitewell area didn't take too kindly to you just appearing on the scene. Was there any opposition from the other churches to you at that particular time?
The opposition was strange. It was, ignore him and he'll go away. Yeah. That was the sort of opposition that I had. They didn't preach out against me in the neighbourhood. They just ignore him and he'll go away. But now they knew that I wasn't a Johnny-come-lately, and I was there to stay. And I have stayed, and I've outstayed them. They're all away now, and I'm still here. And God has been good and given us thousands of precious souls from every walk of life.
And that's no exaggerating.
And our church was in a nationalist area. It was a Protestant area when we first came 41 years ago. It was 75% Protestant.
That's correct.
But now it has turned. Now it's 90% Catholic. But we still labored there until we got this great sanctuary built. Yes. And we would have stayed there, even in that nationalist area, because I got on well with the people. I must say that.
Quite a few of them were coming
to
your wedding.
That's right. My church was packed and cars were parked up their driveways in every way. And, you know, those people were long-suffering. They let that happen because they knew that the people were coming from all over the province to hear the gospel and to hear the word of God.
Yeah.
So I had a good relationship with the people.
Of course, you soon discovered in that little orange hall that plans and things were going to have to change because the property became too small by far. You'd expanded as much as you could and began to look for new land and eventually you found it and you moved up the road a bit.
Well, we were 12 years in the orange hall.
Hmm.
Then we built the church at the bottom of the road. We were 12 years in that.
Yeah.
And then we built the church at the top of the road. We were 13 years in that. Mm. And now we're in this church here.
Yeah.
So it's been step by step. And as the growth has come, you know, we've always had to buy a new building or put up a new building. So I hope that we're staying in this one. I hope I'm not building anymore. Too old, Wilbur.
Not a bit. No retirement in this employment. Your new sanctuary was known as the Little Church with a Spire, and God, the Holy Spirit, was beginning to move in miraculous ways in that place, especially in September 1973. Now, this certainly excited me whenever I read this. What happened to you at that particular time? You had a message for your people not to come to the church. Not to come to church. Here you are, you're inviting people, and then all of a sudden, one Sunday, you stood up and you said, I don't want you to come to church this week.
Yes, the crowds was coming so much.
Hmm.
I said, look, will you stay away and let the unsaved come? And they were taken back at that. But prior to that, Wilbur, you talked about an experience. We were in the little building at the bottom of the road. When we opened it, it seated 450. And at that particular time, I'd grown from 60 to 120. And we were a typical Pentecostal church. People listening to this might misunderstand, but just listen carefully. I was preaching Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, the Monday night prayer meeting, the usual things that would happen in a Pentecostal meeting, two or three ministries in tongues and interpretation of prophecy. And we were doing this week in and week out, but not getting anywhere. And I remember saying, Lord, surely you want more than this. And I began to seek God's face. I began to walk out at night, in the middle of the night. Sometimes the police saw me and brought me home in their, what we call their pig, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they said, you shouldn't be out walking, particularly the Antrim Road and mm-hmm. all the areas where there's trouble. But I was seeking God. I says, man, I'm all right. And they used to follow me. The police used to follow me and bring me home. And I was seeking God. Also, too, I used to go into the church and seek God in the church.
Yeah.
But then if people saw my car at the church, they would wrap the door and come in and talk to me. So what I used to do was park my car at Greymount, run through a few ladies' gardens.
Yes.
They knew what I was doing, waved to them, and got in through the back door of my church. So nobody knew I was there. I was seeking God day and night. And I remember one afternoon in September 1973.
Yeah.
I'd been up in the gallery, and this man came in. And I said, how did you come in? He says, I can come in anywhere. And every door was locked. And that experience changed my life. He was a messenger. And he told me of the future of the church and what we would do.
Mm-hmm.
And I have tried to keep according to what I was told. I've never went to the right or to the left. No matter what has come to town or what so-called move of God there is or what is called the current move of God that we're hearing today, I have kept to what he told me. And you, Wilbur, and Brother Horner here has seen God working here until he has given me 3,500 people to minister and to pastor. Now, he spoke to me. He told me what I had to do. And after he had spoke to me, he just disappeared. Now, angels have appeared as men. And as the apostle said, be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for some have entertained angels unawares. And that was my experience. But he had already visited me when I was a boy. And that was the second major visit. I remember when I was in Spring Street, it was a little kitchen house. And do you remember those days? Brother Horner would remember, there was no electric light, just gas mantle.
That's right.
And here with my mother dead,
mm-hmm.
just living with my father and sister at that particular time, I was sleeping in the front room. And I remember this night I was reading the book William Carey,
yeah,
the cobbler that God sent to India.
Yeah.
And I remember getting out of bed and saying, I yield my life to you, Lord. Would you send me somewhere? Would you use me? Yeah. There was such a desire.
Yeah.
And I remember looking at the mantle, and here was the distinctive part about this mantle that was burning. There was a hole in it, and there was a blue light coming out of it.
Yeah.
If you remember, you know,
that's
the old gas mantle,
when it was broken.
It was broke. But that mantle got bigger and bigger and bigger and filled the whole room. And this visitor came and spoke to me again. And that messenger has been with me for most of my life, and that has been the secret of this great house. Because I have kept all that he has told me to do and I will keep it until the day God takes me.
Beautiful experience.
I've had visions, yes, and I've had dreams. I've even held them in my hands. I never knew my dreams would slip right through. Like they were only grains of sand. Oh, but the anchor holds. Oh, the ship is fathomed. The anchor.
Once again, it was back to the digging and the foundations and the mixing of cement, supported, of course, by many of your friends and members of your congregation. And it was not very long until two new men were brought into full-time service.
That's
right. To bring extra men in to help out.
I had indeed, that's right.
Yeah.
Those were the first two.
Are they still with you?
Yes, they're still here today. And then, in fact, they were the beginning of a full-time ministry of 11.
There's 11
pastors now, and I'm number 11. So that's the whole lot of us there.
Yeah.
But it takes it to look after
for
this
the administration.
Great house.
Yeah.
Now, I have also two secretaries as well. I have two full-time caretakers. I have a full-time electrician. I have a full-time manager. I have a full-time mechanic. On and on and on. We have a staff of about 23 persons.
From now on, you decided that this great house of God was to be called the Metropolitan Church, Whitewell. Now, that's not this particular one.
The one on the top of the
last one.
That's right.
Prior
yes,
to this.
Yes.
Why did you change the name? It was well known throughout the city as the Whitewell Church. That's all it ever got. Mm. Where do you go to? I go to Whitewell. And then you decided to change to the Metropolitan Whitewell.
Well, two reasons. I knew that the building that we were now in wasn't going to be big enough to hold the people that were coming.
Mm-hmm.
We just had that building up 2 years when it was packed. And I lay back on my oars for a while, because at that time we'd been to the King's Hall and we'd been all sorts of places. And the crowds were coming and I began to get lazy. I began to rest on my oars and say, I have it made. But the growth was fantastic. They were sitting in anterooms. They were everywhere. Can you imagine a 1,500-seater trying to hold 2,200? Yeah. And that's what was coming to me on a Sunday
night.
That's right. And I thought that was wonderful, but that growth didn't last because people didn't want to sit in rooms.
That's
people
right.
didn't want to sit in foyers, even though they were watching
That's
little
right.
televisions. People wanted
to
be in there. And I was silly because I should have immediately looked for ground. When that dawned on me, I said, forgive me, Father. I'm going out now to look for ground. And I found this particular piece of land that
yes.
we're in now. But at that particular time, I said, it's time to change your name, because God was giving us other little churches. Young men were leaving me and going out. And Spurgeon's Metropolitan Tabernacle had a great effect on me, reading his life story and the life of the tabernacle in London. So I decided then to call ourselves the Metropolitan Church.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Metro meaning mother, you know, because we were mothering other churches as well. And hence, that's why we're known today as the Metropolitan Tabernacle.
This latest Metropolitan Church at Whitewell that we're sitting in today on the outskirts of Belfast on the Loch Shore, I have to be very honest about this. I've been to America and parts of Europe, but this is the most beautiful sanctuary, I can say without a doubt, in Europe. It was estimated at the time to cost around about £3.5 million. However, like all building work, James, when it was completed, its cost had risen to almost $7 million. And its value today, goodness, it must be double that, I'm sure.
I think to coax the people, $3.5 million was phenomenal. But I realised it would be much more. But sometimes a leader has to hide things from his people.
That's right.
As Paul said, I have things to say to you, but you can't take them now. But It cost to get in $7.5 million. We raised $6 million and we had to borrow $1 million to get in. Then our two properties were taken off us. As you know, there was a controversy about that. Our properties were taken off us. And we were in here 1 year when we put up our youth center. Now, that is 4.5 years ago. The properties now are worth over £11 million. God has been good to us. When we started 41 years ago with 10 people, our first offerings was £8, 10 shillings and sevenpence. That was our first offering. And God has been good to us right now.
Oh, yes.
And he has given us properties of £11 million.
People from all walks of life come to this church. I was reading in your book that there's judges, lawyers, policemen, IRA members, terrorists from both communities, the poor and the rich. And even on Sundays, the choir of 340 to 360, the beautiful choir, sanctuary choir, they sing here. And there's 340 to 360. That's as much as congregations in some churches. However, there's other talented groups within the church as well, inside that choir.
Norman has winnowed the choir down to 300 people now.
I've known you, Pastor McConnell, for some years now, and Evangelist James Horner, who is also with us here in your office, has known you from your early days, and you're still as enthusiastic in the work of the Lord as you ever were in those eventful years, so much so that you've not even taken 1 week off for a holiday in years. How do you keep going, James?
Well, like Brother Horner, I'm getting on, and like yourself, I'm getting on.
Go easy.
I promise the Lord I won't waste a day. I will take a holiday. I will take a holiday eventually. But as I told you, we borrowed money to get in here. We borrowed money to get in here, and we're paying that off. And have other projects on. Before I retire, I want to put up an old people's home.
Yeah.
I want to be in it myself. So I'm putting up this old people's home. We're trying to purchase a piece of land across the way here. And that'll cost us maybe £3 or 4 million. But I'm trying to do that. That's my last act for the Whitewell people before I retire. I've asked God to give me 9 more years. I'm 61 years of age.
Yeah.
And I've asked him to give me 9. And when I'm 70, I'll call it a day. And I'm hoping that by then God will raise up the vessel that he has for this place.
Yeah.
I have a wonderful team of pastors.
You have.
Dedicated, talented young men. But I need somebody, a charismatic leader. And I say that with a small
That's
C.
Right. Yes.
Someone gifted with many operations and with many gifts to be able to take over this house and to be a blessing in it. So that's what I'm looking forward to.
Must be very exciting sitting on a Sunday night or even during the week and knowing that through the doors of this magnificent sanctuary, 7,000 people come each week, counting all the services. It's a great achievement. And to you, Pastor McConnell, we're more than indebted to you for taking the time, because you're so busy, to speak to us here on the Hour of Deliverance. We appreciate it so much. And we know that God will continue to richly bless you. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you. And God bless you. And I trust that someone out there today who needs the Savior might call upon him, because the Savior met me as a boy of 7.5, and he can meet you wherever you are and meet you at the point of your need and deliver you and make a man and a woman out of you. God bless you.
Thank you so much. Well, we trust that you enjoyed that, the second part of our interview with James McConnell here on the Hour of Deliverance. This was recorded at the Metropolitan Tabernacle, Whitewell, here in the lovely city of Belfast. And it's the home of the UK's largest congregation. At this point, I would like to remind you of Pastor McConnell's two books. One is titled The Light on a Hill, and his latest publication, which is selling exceptionally well, is titled The Seer's House. So to obtain copies of these interesting stories of faith containing greater insight into James McConnell's life and witness,
complete with pictures taken over the years. Phone us right after the broadcast or write to us. I'll be giving you all the details in just a moment. Now, we trust that you were blessed by James's testimony of God's intervention in his life, and if the message raised any questions with you, or if you feel you would like to know God in a deeper way through what you have heard on this program, or if you would like prayer for any need, emotional, physical, or spiritual, then our evangelist James Horner is with us right here in the studio at this moment, and he's ready to talk with you and pray with you in total confidence. Also, if you would like a copy of this program and the last featuring James McConnell's life story, don't hesitate to write or phone us immediately after this program. But make sure that you've got your pen and paper ready now for to take down our telephone number and our address. So for any help or information, our phone number is Belfast 702-860. That's Belfast 702-860. Now the code for Belfast is 02890. That's 02890. That's for the United Kingdom. And from Southern Ireland, it's 04890. That's 04890 from Southern Ireland. That number again for Belfast, by the way, is 702-860. And our address to write to, if you prefer to write to us, it's James Horner, P.O. Box 312. That's James Horner, P.O. Box 312, Belfast, BT87XH, Northern Ireland. Belfast, BT87XH, Northern Ireland. Our email address, by the way, is info@hodbc.freeserve.co.uk. And so for myself, Wilbur Fitzgerald, James Horner, and all the studio team right here in Belfast, it's goodbye, and God bless you all. Goodbye. I feel